Hey guys, grab your seats. We're about to dive in. This week, you're going to learn about the different manuscripts that were written, thousands of them about the Bible. How do we know what's accurate? How do we know what version of the Bible we should be reading? Is King James really the best one? What about the contradictions in the Bible? But really, what about the Book of Enoch? We all want to know, what about these books that were left out of the Bible? So let's roll. Welcome to the Pastor's Hangover. My name is Melissa, and each week I get to chat with some pastors at Grace Family Church. And this episode is going to be for the skeptics, the Bible nerds, the nine-year-olds who have questions that are unanswered, whatever about the Bible. Each week I get to chat, and I think I just live the dream because I just think everyone wants to be able to pull up a chair and ask some pastors the hard questions. So pull up your chair. Let's dive in. We have Pastor Nate Ritchie with us today.
Hey, guys. How are we doing?
Pastor Daryl Black.
Hello, hello.
And Pastor Doug Otto.
Welcome, welcome.
Welcome to the show. So we're just going to jump right in because we are overflowing with one, questions, two, with just content from Daryl's message he shared. It was spectacular in how much information he fit in one sermon.
Yeah.
Wow. I mean, that was ridiculous. His message was called, Why Can You Trust the Bible? And go watch it on YouTube. You're going to need it. You're going to need that information to go alongside this podcast episode. But Daryl, any hot takes, any overflow, anything initial
any
you want to share?
Wow.
So many emails.
The emails are awesome. I love the emails. Some of the emails are legitimate questions, and then some of the emails are gripes.
Yeah.
Because some of them are like, well, you didn't answer this. Or, you know, I don't know who said that, but I saw a post. Someone sent this to me saying, your Bible is false. We've debunked the flood. Now, I don't know who we was that he was in reference to, but I would love to know whoever that person is. Hey, what resources are you getting that from? Because there are resources outside of the Bible that affirm that a flood actually happened. Yeah. Even scientists today will affirm, man, that there was a worldwide catastrophic event that could not have been a meteor. It had to be a natural disaster event. Because even the way that they found dinosaurs' bones laid, because they're finding them in entire groups.
Yeah. In layers,
So that could have only happened if it was a water disaster of any kind. So, but you know, that's just me.
All right. Well, let's just start because the only issue we're gonna have this episode is just wrangling in all these questions.
Yeah,
so, right.
The first thing Daryl kind of left us on a cliffhanger in his message was he talked about the quantity of manuscripts that we have. Yeah. Of the Bible and how the quantity and the historical times and how close it was to the originals, all of this leads to the accuracy of the Bible that we have. So the question that you left us with was, with all of these different manuscripts and all these different people, scribes, writing the manuscripts, right? There was no printing presses in the times. Why wouldn't there be errors? Like mass errors. What do we have to say about that?
That's good. Very good question, because a lot of skeptics like to say it's been copied, it's been rewritten, then that there are errors. So there's something called textual critics. So these textual critics, their job is to go and look at manuscripts and make sure that they match. And so there's a guy by the name of Bart Ehrman who was really famous. He's really famous. He's a New York Times bestseller. He wrote a book called Misquoting Jesus. And in his book, he recognized him and a couple other big nerds who do this for a living. They take all the manuscripts and match them together, and they find out if there are any differences. What they found is that there were what's called 400,000 textual variants. In other words, there's 400,000 places where the manuscripts don't line up.
Correct.
And so if I just told you that, and someone said, oh, see, you got you.
Right.
There's 400,000 places where the Bible don't line up. And he puts this in his book, and those are the textual variants. And he's right. There are 400,000 places. And if you did the math, because the Bible, the New Testament only has about 138,000 words in it. So that would mean for every word, there's 2.5 variants. So that alone, if you walked away with that alone, you'd be like, I can't trust the Bible.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What he doesn't say is that 70% of those textual variants are in language, meaning how it's spelled.
Yeah.
So this is the part that's amazing. Though when the textual critics, they can find out geographically who wrote what because of how they spelled. They weren't errors.
Right.
They're just differences.
Correct.
For instance, the name John can be spelled with one N, two N's, or with an E at the end.
Yep.
It depends on where you're from.
Huh.
So it does. So while one manuscript might say John is spelled, and I'm using English, but it wasn't in English, clearly, J-O-H-N. Another one says J-O-H-N-N, and another one says J-O-H-N-N-E. Well, which one's right? They're all right.
Yeah.
Because that's how they wrote it in the geographical area they're from.
Yeah.
Or like American English versus British English.
Yes.
The word color, C-O-L-O-R, C-O-L-O-U-R. Well, which one is right?
They're both right.
Yeah.
So he doesn't define, he doesn't say that 70% of those textual variances are in spelling, which they are. Now, another 29% of those textual variances are in, it's like English translated from one thing to the next, so translated from one language to another language. So it's not a change in the meaning, but it's saying it different. I'll use this example.
Yeah.
If I was to say, man, that guy really be tripping. Well, if I was going to write that in Italian, they don't have a word for tripping. Mm. So their word will be, that guy is really irresponsible.
Mm-hmm.
So which one's right?
They're both right.
Both right.
They're both right.
Right. Yeah. Right.
So the other 29%
Were those issues.
So does it change the meaning?
No.
Nope.
Not at
so
all.
So we haven't changed the meaning because of spelling, nor have we changed the meaning because of thought.
Mm-hmm.
So the less than 1% that's left over is like in 2 Thessalonians chapter 7. In one version, it says, we were like little children.
Yeah.
And the other version, it says, What does it say? Hold on, let me get it right. It says, we are like little children, or the other one says, like, we were patient. Mm. And so it's two different versions. So people will look at that. And again, when I say this is 0.7%, man, these are two differences, but do these two differences change the meaning of the word?
No.
And so it's like, it's apioid agonatha or apioid agonathu. So you hear the difference.
Uh-huh.
They're so close. It's like, well, was he gentle or was he kind?
Mm-hmm. Mm. It's like, yes.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
Exactly. Yes. There's a version in early NIV versions where it says, one version says that Jesus was compassionate.
Yeah.
And another version says Jesus was indignant.
Mm.
Uh-huh.
You might think, oh, those are two different words.
Yeah.
Well, no. They both mean I saw something and I did something.
Uh-huh.
Compassion means he saw it and he did it.
Yeah.
Indignant means he saw it and he did it. Mm-hmm. So they mean the same thing. So that's the less than 1%. And of all of the textual critics in the world who study this manuscript, none of them will say that any of these variances change the meaning of the text.
Mm, right.
And that's the stuff that, like Bart Ehrman, they won't tell you. So are there any errors in the Bible?
No.
So even when it comes to, well, that person was writing and that person were writing, they were so secure in the writing.
Yeah.
One, you get people you trust. These are not just a bunch of randos.
No.
Right.
You get people that you trust who are going to write those things. And that person will always have another person making sure that what you wrote is matching up with what you copied.
Yes.
If not, we burn the whole thing and throw it away.
I remember reading examples where these scribes, if they made an error, like they not only threw out that verse or that chapter, but like the whole book was like, we're not even going to include it. You got to start back in chapter 1, verse 1,
mm-hmm.
because of their passion for getting it right.
Absolutely.
And so the idea that, it was like, we'll be okay with that.
Yeah. No.
It was taken so seriously.
So seriously. And these large pieces of papyrus that they were writing on, you're writing on the front and back.
Yeah.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. And so it's like,
you throw it away.
It's like if you get all the way to the end and on the backside you make a mistake,
it's like
we
got to
get rid of the whole
thing
and we start over from scratch.
That's how important it was. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I hope that answers that question.
Oh, it absolutely does. Is there anything you two want to add on that, or we will jump to the next question?
I think when it comes to, you know, the differences of languages, that one just makes so much sense. Because even for us, it's like if I copy and paste something that's in Spanish and use Google Translator to do it in English. Like, mm-hmm. it's like, oh, that sentence doesn't fully make sense like in English, but I totally understand what they're trying to say because right. of the language differences. Yeah. So mm-hmm. it definitely makes sense.
And there, yeah. and there are the, even when we're talking, jumping from areas to, cause you jump there when we're talking about translations and yeah. people go, oh, there's all these different yes. translations. When people are translating the Bible, you're not translating from another translation.
Yes, correct.
You're translating from the original.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So it is a direct translation. So it's like, so we're yeah. not translating from Spanish into English.
No.
We're
right.
translating from Greek Aramaic, and Hebrew
yeah.
into English. And yeah. that's what all the translations. And there are three different versions of translation that you use. There's word for word, thought for thought, and phrase for phrase.
Correct. Yep.
Yeah.
A lot of the Bible versions that we have are word for word. Yep. So NIV, not NIV, ESV, King James Version, NASB,
yep.
those are word for word, as close as you can get for word for word. Then the NIV is thought for thought and sometimes word for thought, mm-hmm. which is, it's not really a paraphrase, but it's an understanding.
Yeah.
This is what this means. And then you have translations like the Message Bible, which is purely a phrase.
Yeah. Yeah.
Phrase for phrase translation. Yeah. And so when people go, well, should I be reading from the Message Bible? There's nothing wrong with reading from it, but yeah. the Message Bible reads more like a devotion.
Yeah.
Don't right. study from
no.
it.
Right.
It's a devotion.
Because so we would claim that the Message Bible isn't the inspired word of God because it is a paraphrase. It is not a version of the Bible,
right.
correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. So yeah. it's like somebody saying, this is what the Bible says, and then they're giving you a summary.
Yeah.
It's right. like, well, no, Jesus didn't say a summary. He yeah. told you the story.
Correct.
And that's what the Message
yeah,
Bible
Yeah, there's
does.
Almost a little interpretation built into that summary.
Exactly.
So, yeah. yeah.
And nothing wrong with using it in yeah. the sense of like your own study is just to say like when you're reading scripture, I think there's better things to use an actual version of the Bible of the NASBs, the ESVs, the word for
right.
word type of translations that is actually the inspired word of God.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. King James, New King James, those you study from those.
Yeah.
yeah.
And then if you're teaching or you want to say it in a simpler word, sometimes you can go to a Message Bible. Sometimes, not even all the time.
Yeah.
But Eugene Peterson, right?
Yes.
He was the guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
yeah.
Absolutely.
So what is the primary version that you guys read out of?
I use the NIV primarily.
That's okay. fun.
Yeah.
Mine's different. So I mean the Bible app, Logos on so I read from a lot of different ones. I tend to study out of ESV and NASB. Those are kind of my two go-tos. But then when I preach to youth, I often do it in NIV just because it does a very good job of contextualizing the thoughts into kind of their language in which they're doing. And so
Are you saying I have an immature mind? Is that what you're saying?
I'm glad you picked up on it. No. I just tend to preach out of NIV to our students. But for my own study, it's definitely ESV and NASB.
That's what you have there, right?
Yep.
Yeah. oh, me?
Yeah.
Well,
the people want to know.
Yeah.
These are the questions we get, right? It's like, okay, help me understand the biblical understanding. Okay, how do the pastors apply that in their life?
Yep.
Like, that's pretty much the standard of questions that we get on the podcast. So I always want to ask what you read.
Yeah, I grew up reading King James, so that's what I'm most comfortable with. Those are I've memorized verses the most in King James Version.
Yeah.
So, and it is
it's the only inspired word of God.
I mean that's a thing.
Yeah,
that
is
and because it is a direct word for word, I love it that way.
Yeah.
I do read other I read NIV, I read NASB, I read the ESV. But when I'm studying, it's usually King James, and sometimes ESV too.
He's also a big Romeo and Juliet fan, so.
Big.
No, but I would say KJV's great, and KJV's great, but when it comes to choosing your translation of the Bible, just be careful, because there are versions that I would not recommend to anybody.
Mm-hmm.
A version that has kind of caught wind recently and just gained some traction is actually the Passion Translation.
Yeah.
And that's something that I actually was using just for a short bit, because what I thought it was the Passion City, like they did their own project type of thing in Atlanta. But it actually is not that. A guy kind of took the Bible and started to adding his own thoughts and his own dreams into it.
Oh,
and so what you find in the Bible, there's a lot of things that have been added that aren't actually from God, but it's from this man that has claimed that, you know, God's been speaking to him in dreams, which he then has made the Passion Translation within the Bible. So I would say the biggest thing is like, it is important that everybody is reading their Bible, spending time in God's word, but definitely do your research on, you know, how is this translation even created? What's the history behind this translation so that, you know, that you're reading a credible version of scripture.
Yeah, that's good. And just one more question on the overflow of the message, kind of one of the cliffhangers you left us on. And then we're going to dive into the books that aren't in the Bible. The Book of Enoch, we got a lot of questions on, right? How do we know what books to trust? So I love that we already addressed what versions of the Bible to trust. But we're going to get into it. The last question on the message specifically that you brought up is the Bible full of contradictions? Mm. One of the specific questions we got was, it seems like there's so many inaccurate things the Bible is giving to us, like teaching us to drink wine is okay, especially in the New Testament, and God specifically telling us if we want to be closer to him, we should stay away from wine and anything grape related by any means. Can you explain some of these contradictions?
Awesome. I'm gonna let Nate talk. Yeah. We were talking about this before, so I'll let you start.
I'd first start saying, like, the question is loaded in itself of like, can you explain these contradictions? One, they're not contradictions. And so let's start with that ground is like, I'm not going to answer, can we explain the contradictions? Because they're not. But as you study and you begin to read the Bible, you understand that not everything was written for you, meaning that this, what you're referring to is Numbers chapter 6, verse 3, and it's talking about how, God is giving a command to a certain group of people, saying that, hey, you should stay away from these things. He's not saying, hey, everyone in the world, you need to be staying away from these things, but he's actually giving it to, I think it's the Ninevites, correct? Or is it?
Nazarites.
The Nazarites. Mm-hmm. He's giving it to the Nazarites at the time. But what I love what you were talking about out there is like, man, but the principle is still there. Can you explain that?
Yeah, I mean, he you said, he told the Nazarites that I want you to abstain from grapes for a specific reason and a season. Correct. So this wasn't a worldwide command. This wasn't even a command to all of the children of Israel. This was for these people for this time for a reason. So it would be like, hey, I need you to stop eating carbs for 30 days.
Right.
Yeah. Because we're trying to achieve something.
But just the people in Temple Terrace.
Yeah, just the people in Temple.
So that brings up such a good point, because a lot of scripture is descriptive. It describes what was going on.
Yes.
It's not prescriptive where it's everybody needs to do it.
Yeah. Exactly.
Like, this is instructions for everyone. Yeah. So being able to discern, okay, what is this passage about? And who's it for?
Yeah, right.
And does it apply, or is it just describing what took place?
Yeah, exactly. Now, when you get into the prescriptive, when we're talking about wine, you're looking at Ephesians 5 and 18. You're looking at Proverbs 23, where it's talking about, hey, don't get drunk with wine.
Right. Yeah,
don't get drunk with excess.
Correct.
He's actually not saying don't drink it. He's saying, this is talking about irresponsibility.
Yeah.
Don't be irresponsible. And in Proverbs 22, he talks about, if you're irresponsible, here's what it's going to look like.
Yeah.
There is going to be confusion. Mm-hmm. There is going to be nonsense in your life. There is, these are the things. And so don't be irresponsible with what you have. So he's not saying don't do it, but he's saying, man, have some self-control.
Yeah.
If you don't have self-control, here's what the response is going to be like. And this is what your life is going to look like. He says, drinking wine will lead to debauchery.
Yeah. Right.
Basically is what he's saying. And then in Romans, I like to use Romans 14, where it says it's better not to eat meat or drink wine or do anything that will cause your brother to stumble. So there are people, I'm one of those people. I don't drink wine. I never have. I don't care about it. Any of that. Some of that is religious in the house that I grew up in. Yeah. But some of that is I was around a lot of people that drank.
Yeah.
And I saw what it did to their lives. And so I made a commitment that, no, that's not what God has for me. And I want to be an example, and I want to stand out, and I want to show them, yo, I'm still fun without spirits.
Right.
And even in Ephesians, it said, if you're going to be filled with anything, be filled with the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Why? Because Jesus is fun.
Yeah.
if you need to drink to have fun, you ain't fun.
No. No, yeah, he's.
I mean,
yeah. Time to do a self audit.
Hello,
something's not fun
about
you.
I might even say you might not. No, let me not say.
I'm not going to
say.
What are you going to put yourself under the influence?
I'm not going to say it.
But I do want to lean into this a little bit because what we're talking about here is, you know, this was written, you know, not to drink or not to eat grapes, right? It was written towards this group of people. What I hear oftentimes is people will say, well, you know, now other things are written just for a certain group of people, right? Like, mm-hmm. you know, not getting drunk or sex before marriage. Like that's the one that comes up a lot. It's like, well, that was for those people back then. Mm-hmm. Like, how would you address that topic of like, you know, in Numbers, it's talking to this certain group of people. Well then, you know, in Ephesians, is it just talking about the church in Ephesus? You know what right. I mean? And so yeah. how would you address that?
I think that's, he made a very good point. You've got to study the text to know the difference between what's descriptive and yeah. what's prescriptive.
Yeah. Right.
The Bible describes a lying.
Yeah.
And people lied. David cheated on his wife yeah. and had a man killed. That doesn't mean we suppose that is behavior that's warranted. It's describing, hey, here's what happened.
Right.
Even in good stuff, whether it's go build something in this place or go heal someone. Hey, this was descriptive for that moment. Jesus told Peter to walk on water.
Mm-hmm.
He says, come. That was descriptive, yeah. not prescriptive.
Yeah. He's not that's telling not, us to go. He's not,
and not saying that you can't walk on water. Yeah. Not saying that that's not something that Jesus wouldn't call you to do. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But should you go out there to a lake right now and try your hand at walking on water? No.
Go for it.
That's right? not what that means. And so you've got to spend some time in the Word to go, hey, what's the difference between what God said to them
yeah.
and what he's saying to us?
Right.
Even if we're talking about the Nazarites and what God is telling them, there still is a principle to be followed. Here's the principle. There are seasons in your life where there are things that you need to sustain from
yeah.
so that you can get what God is calling you to get.
Yeah.
yeah.
So even there, that is the same thing. Hey, here's a vow.
Yep.
And in honor of the vow, here's what I want you to not do.
Great. Right.
And God, and that's what we call fasting
yeah.
Yeah.
for a season. Right. It's like, hey, I've got to fast from some things in yeah. a season because there's another level that God is calling me to.
Because you're making a vow with God.
And that's the yeah. principle.
That's good.
Mm-hmm. Cool. What else we got?
Oh, my gosh.
I can keep going on this. You got to stop me.
I'm so excited. Pastor Doug, do you want to share about your show and tell? Yeah,
well,
that
I brought
you
a couple of props. So they're more than props.
It's a giveaway.
But, you know, the...
Pastor Doug yeah. in the YouTube version, and he's going to send you.
When you're talking about manuscripts, number of manuscripts, yeah. accuracy of manuscripts, Case for Christ, yeah, Lee Strobel, one of the strongest books, Josh McDowell's More Than a Carpenter,
yeah.
Case for Faith.
Oh, yeah.
Case for Faith just answers some big biblical questions and themes. It's again by Strobel. Both of those are well worth your investment and taking time to plow through, and yeah. we'll answer a lot of questions. For those who are more interested or are like, I need to fact check Pastor Daryl.
Yeah.
Let me see what else is written about this.
Yeah.
And I remember someone asking me, you know, I love reading other religious texts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the answer is not, shy away. No, sure. The answer is lean in.
Yeah.
Like, read more. Yeah. You can read a diverse religious text, but yeah. you're going to find that all of it leads. All of the resources that we're telling you to lean into, right? None of them are going to contradict the Bible.
No.
Yeah. So right. the yeah. more that
religious
you lean
text
in
the sense of like text that is in support of the Bible is what you're talking about.
Correct.
Not like the Quran.
Yeah.
Like
which granted, that's what I'm text. Saying. It's yeah. like yeah. There's
that
nothing wrong with reading it to study. You know what yeah. I mean? Like I have yeah. found, that my faith has been able to strengthen in me as a tool for God's kingdom, in the sense of being able to have different conversations mm-hmm. has grown because I've studied other religious texts
right.
that are for other religions.
Yeah.
Now, granted, when it becomes hairy is when you start reading it for spirituality and trying to find yourself or find other things and trying to figure out like putting your own religion type of thing together. That's stay away from that. That's dangerous. Mm-hmm. Like this is the only book that you need when it comes to feeding your soul. But there is something when it comes to, why do people believe? I mean, mm-hmm. Pastor Hal a couple weeks ago did a great job of talking about what other religions believe and why it contradicts what we believe in the Bible. So,
mm-hmm.
Well, I think this is a great start. A question that we got from 9-year-old Mateo.
Mm.
What happened to the sea creatures during the flood and sea animals? Did they die too, even though they live in water? Well, thank you, Mateo, for listening to the pastor's
segment. Glad you're listening, Mateo.
You are my favorite fan, I think, because that is the most adorable question I've ever heard. They all kept swimming during the flood.
Yeah, right.
It's short and sweet. They lived and they kept swimming, and that's why we have all of the...
Sharks and dolphins and whales and alligators. Yeah.
Well, thank you, Mateo. I love that question.
Pastor Daryl loves alligators.
Let's go.
My favorite.
let's go to the Book of Enoch. Is there anything else on the message that I'm missing? Because the biggest question we got was about these missing pages, missing books of the Bible. Mm-hmm. Do they really exist? If so, where? Why were they excluded? They want to know, how can we not trust the other books not added to the Bible, like the Book of Enoch, Book of James, Gospel of Mary, and other books that the Catholic Bible has?
Yeah.
What is Apocrypha? What is the Apocrypha, and were the extra books part of the thousands of manuscripts that Daryl talked about this week? If so, how and when did we decide to exclude that? I like that they said we.
We are that powerful. They're in.
Yeah. All right. So those are the questions people want to know.
It's good.
What about these books? Especially, I think Enoch is the most, the one I see on social media the most.
Wasn't there a movie?
Let me just say that.
Yeah.
Book of Enoch? Or is that? I don't know.
Was there a book?
I thought there was.
Sounds like it might be. Well, what I'd say is that even in the question, like, there's no missing books of the Bible. There are books that have, that were excluded from the Bible when the canon came together and put the, you know, the 66 books that we have in the Bible, and the criteria in which they had in order to actually be a part of the canon were, one, it had to be written by an apostle. Second is it had to be widely accepted from the early churches. And then third, it was about the content of the book. And so was the content of the book congruent with the other books of the Bible that we have from the apostles? And so was the character of God the same? And so a lot of these books that have been excluded from the Bible, like the Gospel of Thomas, for one, it was because the contents of it weren't in line with what the other gospels were talking about. And so, like, for instance, like the Gospel of Thomas talk about that women are inferior to men. And it's like, well, that's not at all what you see throughout scripture. And so there's a lot of things when it comes to these books that people are saying, well, this should be a part of the Bible. It's like, well, they're not, because when the canon came together and put these books together, there was a lot of just differences in that teaching. Then we don't see it throughout the rest of the Bible.
It didn't make the standard.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And when you talked about, I love that visual with all the connecting points, mm-hmm. like that would not have been part of wouldn't have been included in. Yeah. And you got to think through the history of the early church, you got some people writing some things off on their own as they extrapolated or drew their own conclusions from. Mm-hmm. But they wrote them anyway. Yeah. And at a certain point in history, they had to go, whoa. And what are we calling the Holy Scriptures?
Well, and on top of that, when you look at like the Gospel of Thomas, it might be called the Gospel of Thomas, but scholars believe that it was forgery, that someone just put Thomas's name on it as an apostle to gain authority within the text. But it's not in line with the story that we see in Thomas, and as well as, you know, the teachings as well. Same thing with the Book of Enoch is, you know, maybe a little bit was written by Enoch, but for the most part, it is widely believed that people were actually using Enoch's name to gain authority as the Book of Enoch was getting created. So,
yeah.
I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
No, that's good. I mean, it's a question that comes up all the time where people say, well, they took books out of the Bible. They did not take any books out of the Bible. Those books never made the canon. Yeah, canon means measuring stick, means the standard. And so you mentioned three of the standards, and the other standard was it had to be divinely inspired or revelatory.
Yep. Yep.
And so that was the fourth criteria. And so none of these books had all of those four criteria. So when the church fathers got together, they didn't choose what books would be go in the Bible. They recognize what books would be the standard. So people like to say, oh, they picked those. No, they didn't pick them. Mm-hmm. They looked at what was already there. And understand this, we already had the Old Testament.
Correct.
Right. Yeah. Right.
So we already had a reference.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When we got to the New Testament. So they already had a reference to go, okay, this is how God speaks. This is what God sounds like. So we know what to be looking for when we put these two things together.
Yep.
And so these books, the 66 books that we currently have, of the 27 that were the in the New Testament, they were in circulation in the church.
Yep.
And so a lot of people like to say, well, they decided the books in the Council of Nicaea in 325. That's not what that was at all.
No.
That's not where they decided where the books of the Bible were going to go in. The books were already in circulation before that. Now, the canon of the scripture, when they put all the books together, didn't happen until the Council of Carthage in 419 AD. That's when they put them all together. Mm-hmm. But all of them were already in circulation. These other books weren't in circulation. The Book of Enoch never establishes that Enoch is the author.
Correct.
And the Book of Enoch is actually several books inside. So again, it doesn't meet the canon. Now, it has some extraordinary history in it. It tells some great stuff. A majority of this book, like the Apocrypha books, which are 14, 15 books altogether, majority of those books were written in the 400-year period where God wasn't speaking.
Correct.
Between the and so while it does give a history, it talks about Jewish Jewish culture and many of the traditions. Those things weren't inspired by God, and they don't even say they were inspired by God. Now, what the reason that people would say that those things were taken out, because early the Catholic Church started using them along with the canon to describe, hey, these are some other things that were happening. And so the reason that the Evangelical and the Protestant Church said, no, we're not using that, because it's not the inspired word of God. So it was never in the canon, and then the Catholic Church decided to add the Apocrypha books as a part of the text, because they were already using the Septuagint, which was some of that. I know this is a whole lot of stuff.
No, this is important.
That's good.
So they were using the Septuagint. So there's the Apocrypha and there's the Pseudo-Apocrypha. So there's more than just the Apocrypha. I'll add it this way.
Yeah, break it down for us.
So people will go, well, why don't we add all those books to the Bible? In the last chapter in the book of John, it said Jesus did many more things than this.
Yeah.
Can't add them. There's not enough books to add them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We can't add everything that was written about men. There was I can't remember the author's name. He said, if we added all the books together of all the things that happened, not including all the stuff that Jesus did, but all the things that everybody wrote during that period, it would be over 1,500 books in one book.
Yeah.
Wow.
Make your heads bigger, actually.
That's taller than Pastor Craig.
That's taller than Pastor Craig.
Yeah. So that was some shade. They are throwing shade.
But that would be a lot of books. There's no way. So even in the inspired word of God that John is writing, God is telling him, you cannot write everything. And so when people say, well, why didn't they include this? Why didn't they include more about the story of Mary? Is it suppressing the story of Mary? No, it's not suppression of the story.
Yes, that's what we got.
It's about, hey, what's the point of the message?
Correct.
Right.
What we know about Mary
is
important, and we don't need to know any more else.
It's everything we need. We also don't hear more about Joseph.
And his story is incredible, too.
Correct.
But there's not more of that story as well.
Because what's the goal of the Bible?
The goal of the Bible is Jesus.
Yeah.
And so if he's the central point, then why would we spend a considerable amount of time talking about so many other people?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
the follow-up question I'd love to hear from Pastor Doug is, can we trust what's in these other books? So
Pastor Doug.
The Book of Enoch accurate if someone goes reads it?
The short answer is I don't know the answer to that question. I haven't studied the Apocrypha, so I really don't know exactly what's in there.
Yeah.
My guess is there's probably some things that are true, right? Like some historically accurate and reflected the Jewish culture accurately.
Yeah.
But here's what I would say is that all truth is God's truth.
Yeah.
Right. So if it's true, it's God's truth.
Yeah.
Just because it's not in the Bible doesn't mean it's not true or accurate.
Yeah.
Obviously, but not being a scholar on the Apocrypha, I would be very careful to do your research, because I do think there's, I don't know if it's the Maccabees, but I think there's some funky things in there that are like, I don't know where that.
Well, if you can look at that, I mean, that's like in those books, that's where the idea of purgatory comes from. It's like, well, that is, you know, obviously Catholicism, they believe in, you know, purgatory. Well, that's not found anywhere in the other books of scripture, which is why, like, a big reason why we don't believe in purgatory, because
praying to the saints.
Yeah, we don't have that. But if you look at the Book of Enoch, to your question, is like, is it in my study of the Book of Enoch, it's like, sure, like, there's some historical stuff that you can learn from it, but be careful, because there's also things that it teaches that just are not true stories of, like, when it comes to, like, the fallen angels. Like, the Book of Enoch talks a lot about the fallen angels, and the fallen angels had babies with women of the earth. And so it does get into some stuff where it's like, all right, that's not actual, like, that's not backed by scripture. And so I just say there's a reason that it's not in the Bible, because if it was in the Bible, then we would see it as God-inspired truth. Mm-hmm. So
that's the number one, honestly, story that I see kind of floating around on social media, yep, is that the Book of Enoch was removed, which we've already talked about. It was not removed.
Correct.
Because these fallen angels were in a bad light.
Yeah.
And God doesn't want to show us that, so they took it out of the Bible. And I don't know why. I just keep seeing that, you mm-hmm. know, reel or clip that people keep
The danger
posting.
Is it leads to bad theology.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Correct. Yep.
Absolutely. Yeah. We could go so deep. I know we got like 30 seconds. Yeah. We could go so deep in this, but
5 minutes.
I think at the end of the day, people have to look at this. The Bible is not, it's historical in nature, and that history can be verified. So if you have any book, it doesn't matter what that book is, if we cannot verify that history, we cannot verify it accurately, if there are not enough resources that confirm that those things to be true, you have to take a step back and go, And so I would implore anybody and encourage anybody, let's sit down and talk about the Book of Enoch. Yeah. I've studied it. I've read it. I know what it said.
Yeah.
I've read the Apocrypha. I wanted to know what it said. Now, I'm a different breed. I'm a bit of a nerd. So I want to know what it says. And then I did all the research. I did all the studying. And I go, yeah, this ain't right.
Yeah.
And when there is a standard of what truth is, and when you put everything up against that standard, you have to go, okay.
Yep.
This isn't true. Oh, this doesn't meet the standard, which is why it never made it into the scripture.
Yeah,
and it was widely known that it doesn't meet the standard. And many of these books were written centuries after the Bible had been canonized. And so some of these things that people say, oh, they took it out of the Bible. No.
It wasn't even there.
It wasn't even written.
Right. This book didn't, some of these books that people are saying didn't show up didn't even show up till 1545.
Yep.
And they go, oh, they took that out of the Bible. No, the Bible had been canonized already.
Correct.
So it's like it's a bad argument. And I don't mind the argument. Let's talk about it. Let's debate it. Mm-hmm. But I would say to anybody, hey, bring your resources.
Mm.
Let's have the conversation. But man, check your resources. You can Google almost anything
and go get a book.
You can back your opinion.
Don't easily. Back your opinion.
Yeah, correct.
Find the evidence.
Yeah, that's
and
it.
Then let's talk about what the evidence says. Because I love to read resources. If someone send me resources, when people just say, that's not true. Well, based on what? Because somebody told me. No. Nope.
What's your truth source?
No, go look at the sources. Why I'm always telling people what the resources are, whether that's a book or going to the Bible or find someplace else. Mm-hmm. Listen to Josephus. Listen to Tacitus. Listen to Flavius. They all give you the resources that you can go, even stuff that's outside of the Bible. I'll be talking about some of that this weekend. Things that are outside of the Bible where you can find the resources to prove that the Bible is what it says it is and Jesus did what he said he did.
So.
Yeah.
I have so many more questions.
Oh.
But we have another message from you coming this weekend.
We got another message this weekend.
We have another message on You Asked For It, where we'll be taking your questions again, and whatever ones we didn't get to, we will dive into. I one time got in a biblical debate with Pastor Daryl, and it was so fun. It was on Romans. I remember it. It was so fun for the first 10 minutes.
Did you win?
No,
you didn't win.
Two hours later.
Listen, and it's not about winning.
I was like, I'm done talking about this. Like,
it's never about winning. My goal is never to win.
But you win.
But I did win. My goal is truth.
Yeah, for sure.
Hey, let's find truth. Even if we don't agree, hey, can we agree that that's truth?
Mm-hmm.
And let's set what the standard is. And then let's both reach for the standard.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the Bible encourages us to do that. Even when Paul talks about in Ephesians 3 and 4, when he's talking about we have to keep the unity, he recognizes there's going to be points of contention where there are certain things that we don't agree on.
Yeah.
The thing that I love about the early church is that when they didn't agree, they didn't just go to another church.
Correct.
Right. Let's build another church across town.
Yeah, they didn't just go, you know, I don't like this worship. I'm going to drive down the street and listen to somebody. No, they were like, no, we're going to figure this out.
Right.
We're going to work this out until we can come into unity, peace, and agreement. Yeah. And so I love the fact that the Bible encourages us, no, sit there until you work it out. And if y'all can't work it out, bring somebody else in. Yeah. Y'all work it out. And it still bring some more people in. Correct. We're going to work this thing out together. Why? Because you're my family. You're my people.
Right.
And I'm not just going to walk away or go to another
because
church
of a difference.
Because we don't agree
especially
on this
especially when
point.
It comes to open-handed things, right? It's like, it's like if you're going to a church that doesn't believe Jesus is the Son of God and is, you know, his death is sufficient for our sins, like, then go find a new place. But
we have our non-negotiables.
But if it comes down to, you know, you like hymns, but this is a contemporary type of music, that's not a difference that you should be able to go and find a new church. It's not church shopping. It's I'm going to just dig in and find community here and then use my voice on the things that, that are special to me. And I'm going to send Pastor Daryl an email and you're about to get more emails, but I'm going to at least ask questions. I think coming to Pastor Daryl or anybody with questions of, hey, why do you do it? I mean, that's a great way to be able to respond in our differences of what we like and what we don't like, of just seeking to understand, you know, why does Grace Family Church believe this, or why does Grace Family Church do things this way?
Yeah.
It's good.
Fantastic. Any closing thoughts? We have a whole nother message from Pastor.
Read the Bible. Are you going to read it? Read the Bible.
You know what Pastor Doug said on the first time you were on, and it has like stuck with me.
I don't know. Tell me.
He said, mine your own gold.
Yes.
And he said, mine your own gold. Listening to podcasts and listening to sermons, listening to messages, which is great.
That's
like,
great.
Get in the word and mine your own gold.
Mine your own gold.
That's, I know.
So funny.
It's such a good quote.
I was going to say, it's like don't rely off of somebody else's devotion with God.
Right.
Like, you have to sit
He's
and have
got a message
own.
For you.
100%.
Yeah.
Individually, directly from him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's like, I think all of those resources in front of you are great.
Right.
But they're not supposed to take place of the Bible.
Amen.
And so spending your time studying God's word and asking that question of like, God, where doesn't my life reflect Jesus? Every time you open up God's word, that's what we're supposed to do. Come not with our own agenda, but with the only purpose of opening up God's word and saying, God, like, where doesn't my life reflect this? And then allow the Bible is supposed to make you uncomfortable. Like that's just the honest truth. Like I hear it all the time. People are like, well, I don't like reading the Bible because, you know, it says this and I just don't agree with it. Well, then you probably should dig into that because the Bible is what is true.
Yes, he's right.
And so it's like if the Bible's causing you to feel uncomfortable, you're in a good spot. Dig into that and then figure out what do I need to change in order to have my life reflect the word of God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's good.
Right. Right.
That's it. I'm cutting everybody
That's
off.
It. That's
We're
it.
Done. We're
I just
over time.
Say,
thank you all for being with us today on another episode of The Pastor's Hangover. Join us, Pastor Daryl Black, another message this weekend on You Asked For It series. And this has just been an amazing apologetic series. So thank you guys for being with us today.
You.
And thank you guys for being with us for another episode of The Pastor's Hangover.
See
we'll see you next week.